In this part of our lecture, we just intend to discuss further a few of the important issues relating to state responsibility. Could a state be liable under international law for issues which are unconnected with the contractual obligations? Now, for example, I just mentioned to you the other day, only when there is a rule of international law, and in the event of a violation of its rules, liability of a state will arise. Now, in a particular case, you take it this from me, there is no rule of, no violation of a rule of international law. Violation has not taken place anywhere, but still the act can be attributed to the concerned state. Now, in a case before the International Court of Justice or before the municipal courts, the concerned state, while defending the case, may say, neither we have violated our domestic law, and the domestic law is intact, nor we have an intention, nor we have violated to the rules of existing international law. In circumstances, could there be a liability to such issues? Now, this matter naturally came up before the International Law Commission. The General Assembly of the United Nations, as early as 1970s, in the late 1970s, requested the International Court of Justice to draft a convention. Now, this convention is for injuries unconnected with the contractual obligations. Now, the International Law Commission has been working on this subject, but then we have certain other issues which were prevalent right from 1930s. For the injurious consequences arising out of acts which are not prohibited by international law. Now, this actually is the theme, or the theme which is being given to the International Law Commission to draft a code of conduct. Since 1930 or even much earlier, in the 19th century itself, there are plenty of instances wherein the states, when a matter came before the court of law or before a mixed claims commission, went to the extent of arguing there is no violation of any rule of international law, and but still we are made liable under the existing rules of international law. Now, in situations like this, we have to examine whether the act which is done by a particular state is in accordance with the municipal law or not. Now, if it is in accordance with the municipal law, was there any violation of the existing rules of international law? Now, you take an instance relating to a particular citizens of a particular state. Now, the citizens naturally go to a foreign country for purpose of work. When they start working there, naturally, the place where they are present, they will be the law-abiding citizens of the receiving state. Now, if you take an instance, the other day I made a mention relating to several nationals of the state of India working in the Gulf countries. And although they are citizens, there will be a mutual agreement between the respective governments, maybe the government of the state of Saudi Arabia as well as the government of India. There may be an agreement between the state of Bahrain as well as the state of India. Now, accordingly, as per the provisions of the agreement, the state of India permits its nationals to work there. And when the Indian nationals with the respective qualifications, when they decide to go there, they go there to work with a work permit, and they don't get nationality, and they are just workers, maybe professional workers, maybe hazardous in working in hazardous industries or any other place, maybe working in the corporations of that state or working in the house of certain sheikhs, whatever it be, or in hospitals, doctors, nurses, etc., etc. In situations like this, when they are working and become law-abiding citizens of the receiving state, if some harm is caused to them, or if some obstruction to their very presence is made, whether the act is imputed or it can be made applicable to the concerned host state, which was responsible in permitting them to stay there and work. Now, generally speaking, the concerned state may say that we have been trying to protect them and we have facilitated their protection and we have given all kinds of help and assistance to them. Now, if the state has given protection and if it has done what is required to be done by a particular state, there will not be any kind of liability. But then, the organ of the state which is empowered to enforce law, at times, remember, violates or does not perform. Now, there will be what we call as an ultra-virus act. In circumstances, whether the act which is done by the organ of the state be attributed or imputed to the state. Now, a beautiful case came up in the 1930s, and the name of the case is Yeoman's case. I shall explain to you the facts of the case to understand the point better. Now, there were three American nationals, and all of them are engineers, and all of them had money. These nationals, remember, wanted to make some investment in the state of Mexico. And they have gone there and have established a particular factory. And they made an investment under an agreement which was signed between the state of the United States as well as the state of Mexico. Having gone there, having functioning, they established their unit, a factory, and they employed locals. Now, one fine morning, one of the engineers, he was dispersing the salary on the first of a month. And almost all the Mexican employees working in the company, they were standing on the queue. And they were trying to take the salary. At that time, one of the Mexican nationals who was in the queue picked up a fight. And the fighter slowly and steadily, remember, became very strong. And they started shouting at them, started assaulting the concerned person who was one of the owners. So at that time, the remaining two, one of them was in the house, telephones to the police official. And when he telephones to the mayor of the town to send the police, the mayor telephones the police officers and one of the sergeant along with this troop come to the spot. The sergeant, when he came to the spot, his brief which was given to him by the mayor of the town was very simple: go and quell the mob. Now, these people, instead of quelling the mob and suspending the riot that has taken place there, naturally open fire and kill one of them. Now, at that time, the other two owners started running and they were chased and ultimately they were killed. Now, this is, for example, the police personnel of a particular state are employed for purpose of maintaining law and order. And they were gone there to maintain law and order. They have gone there, they were sent there to suspend the hostilities. And instead of suspending the hostilities and quelling the riot, they opened fire and killed the three owners of the concerned factory. And this is an alien factory who have gone there. Now, could there be liability? Now, suppose, for example, the state of Mexico were to stay before the Mixed Claims Commission that we have instructed our mayor of the town to go send a police force and a police troop and quell the mob. Now, if they have exceeded the scope of their competence, if they are not supposed to do such an act because police are established only to maintain law and order, the act cannot be imputed to the state. Such a plea, such a defense is not tenable under international law. Even for such acts, the concerned state is answerable in international law. Now, you take another instance happened to be, suppose, for example, a riot takes place. During the course of the riot, remember, there cannot be any distinction between aliens and nationals. Now, in situations like this, if the alien property is looted, and remember, if their women are raped, whether these acts which are done by the people be attributed to the concerned state is the question that is being put in. Now, generally speaking, what is being said is, in all circumstances, the concerned state wherein the foreign nationals are working shall be given protection. And protection is at all times to be given. But in spite of the protection, if some minor mishap were to take place, the concerned state is not answerable. Suppose, for example, the riot takes place at the behest of the state itself. Suppose, take it this way, there will be an alien colony. And in that alien colony, some riot takes place. And the riot is actually instigated by the host state itself. In circumstances such as this, naturally the concerned state is answerable in international law. Now, in all circumstances of this type, what we call as international delinquencies, that simply means wrongs unconnected with the contractual obligations, first and foremost, we have to examine the agency of the concerned state. Whether the concerned agency has the power to carry out such act. Then the second one is whether it has exceeded the scope of its competence, or whether instead of performing, it keeps quiet. Suppose, for example, the police force are sent, or some other people have been sent, inspectors or to do something are sent. Instead of doing, remember, they just go into their house and ransack everything and eat and enjoy, listen music and sleep. By that time, their property is completely damaged outside. Even in circumstances of this type, remember, the concerned state is answerable. When I speak about this, it is called as the Ultra Vires Act. In the agencies of state exceed the scope of their competence. And they exceed the scope of their competence, naturally, the act should be imputed to the concerned state because they are employed by the state. Remuneration is being paid by the state. But in all cases of imputability, remember, it is a kind of an intellectual operation. Now, writers in international law explains what is this intellectual operation. Now, first is whether the agency has the power. And if the agency has the power, that is, if the answer is in the affirmative, whether the power that is being exercised in a particular situation be attributed to the state. And if the answer is yes, this is the act which is being done by the agency is being, remember, imputed to the concerned state. Responsibility begins where imputability ends. That is how this is being answered under international law. When we go further, a question that being done is whether the acts of private citizens, and that will be attributed to the concerned state. Or suppose, for example, you can take it this way, there are plenty of instances wherein instead of the government department, some other departments exercising or some people are doing this. Take an instance which is now actually known to everyone these days. One is flood. And few years ago in Tamil Nadu, there was tsunami. Or the third one happened to be earthquake. In instances of this type, remember, the state agency may not be in a position to regulate everything. And remember, the governmental power which is being exercised by the agency may be given to some other organs. So you can take it this way. Now, the core NSS group, student group, national volunteers who wants to serve national service scheme, they are being asked and go to the place where earthquake has taken place to provide and rescue the victims. Or you take another instance wherein, for example, some parties will have their Seva Dals. Congress party has the Seva Dal. And the other party will have Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. So the party requests them to go to the spot and exercise some power so that all of them are put in a safer place. And they should not suffer in situations like this. The only purpose for which the directive is given is to see that, remember, all the victims are protected and taken care. Food, shelter and medicine are given to them at the proper time. Now, in such situations, those who exercise the governmental power violate the norms and loot the property, loot the food stock and they rape the women or ill-treat these foreigners. In circumstances such as this, can the government say, we have not exercised the government power and we have just delegated the government power to somebody, and these people to whom we have delegated the government power are responsible in the commission of the crime? Now, even though the agents to whom the governmental power is delegated, ultimately the concerned act is imputed to the state and it is an act of state, and for the act of the state, the concerned state is liable in international law. That is how it is being answered. Now, plenty of instances of this type have taken place, especially during flood and famine. Now, alien property is being looted and the government simply will say, we have given protection. But in the garb of protection, remember, property is looted. Even in such situations, the concerned state is answerable, provided it proves beyond doubt to the victim that we are innocent, we did not do anything, we wanted to protect you and protect your safety as well as life. Now, these are some of the things which come to our light. Now, the other thing that is being spoken in state responsibility, protection of citizens abroad. Now, when I speak about the protections of citizens abroad, I just told you the dichotomy in this. Each state has the right to protect its citizens, either in this territory, in their homeland, or if they are aliens somewhere in some other territory. Now, when we speak about when the state confers nationality, there will be rights and duties which are reciprocal. Now, just because you are a national of the state, you owe certain duties as well. And just because you are a national, the state, remember, assures you protection. Now, these workers, when they go there, naturally, they are to be protected by the home state of which they hold the passport. Now, the other state will say, we are entitled to, where they are functioning, they may say, we are entitled to exercise jurisdiction on both nationals as well as aliens. Now, where is the distinction that you can drawn in circumstances like this? The first and foremost thing that is being spoken is, jurisdiction naturally can be exercised. But then when the state exercises jurisdiction, it is the duty of the concerned state to refrain from causing any harm to the nationals of that state. And the state should prove beyond doubt to the other state of which they are the nationals and they have suffered, saying that now it has not interfered with any of the activities that has taken place. And it has to come clean. And it should prove beyond doubt that it is innocent under the existing rules of international law. Now, having spoken about this, there are one or two things that is being spoken. In all cases of state responsibility, matter that is being spoken is exhaustion of local remedies. The state will not come into the picture or enter into the picture unless and until the matter is sorted out in the local courts. As I just mentioned to you, there are several nationals working throughout the world. You find Indian nationals in Australia, Indian nationals everywhere. Now, in the event of some happening or some harm that is being caused during the course of the riot, or of losing the property or causing damage, or in the event of any other untold incident, they have to resort to the courts of their country. And only when they resort to the courts of their country, and a matter when it is completely exhausted, and when they don't get the justice, then they go naturally seek the protection of their home state. I just intend to speak to you something relating to Saddam Hussein's annexation or conquest of the state of Kuwait. When Saddam Hussein invaded the state of Kuwait, there were plenty of Indians, lakhs of Indians were there, and half of them left the state of Kuwait, came back. And remember, they came back, they left their entire property, they left their earnings, and huge losses being caused to the Indian population at that time. And thereafterwards, when everything was restored, when Saddam Hussein was thrown out, and when the entire state of Kuwait was restored to its owner, the Sultan of Kuwait, or the rulers of Kuwait. Remember, the ruler of the Kuwait declared that all of them who lost their property, who have lost whatever, will be compensated. No, but then all the nationals by then had, Indian nationals by then had come to the state of India, more than 50 or 60,000 of them. Now then what has happened was, at the government of India established an office. And this office was established at the Indian Society of International Law in the third floor. Now that is relating to Kuwaiti claims. All the Indians who have lost their property in any form are made to submit an application, and they gave the deadline. And all the nationals, remember, whoever, irrespective, he may be a Keralite or he may be an Assamese or he may be a Rajasthani national or a Mumbaikar, anyone, they are supposed to make a description of the property which they had, and that is being lost, monetary loss, everything, economic loss, pecuniary loss, whatever it is, and then submit, and it was reviewed and then submitted to the government, and then at a later stage the compensation came in. Now in all circumstances we say this domestic jurisdiction, that is the local remedy, should be exhausted. Without exhausting the local remedies, you cannot, remember, intervene or make a request to the state to intervene in matters of this type. Now one important thing that comes up to our mind happened to be an issue relating to a state wherein the concerned state is not in a position to award compensation. It is not in a position to award compensation because the courts don't have the power to award compensation in situations of this type. I shall just explain to you a bit later at the appropriate place what is the remedy that is available in situations of this type. Now a case came up, and this case, which is popularly known as the famous Cuttings case. Now the Cuttings case happened to be a case which came up between United States and Mexico. Now Cuttings case was decided in 1887. The facts are very simple. Cuttings was the editor of a newspaper, E.I. Centinela, and there was another newspaper in Texas which is called as El Paso. And remember, one fine morning there was an ad that appeared of the coming into existence of another newspaper by name Revistia International. And Revistia International was financed by one person by name Medina, who is a Mexican, who was a Mexican national and a rich person. Mr. Cuttings wrote an article saying that Mr. Medina is a big fraud, and he is pukka fraud, and no one should read his newspaper. Now Medina, being a rich man, a Mexican, could not keep quiet. He wanted to, remember, try and book and get him arrested, but that was not possible. Because of the pressure that was put, both Medina as well as Cuttings agreed for a compromise. And the compromise was very simple, and in the compromise it is said that he should write an apology letter saying that what he did was wrong, what he published, remember, was supposed to be a libel, is wrong, and in future he will not repeat it. Now Cuttings agreed, but then when he published it, remember, in his newspaper, no one was able to read it. It was put in short words. And Cuttings, when he did that, Medina again was upset. But in another Sunday special, he wrote another article saying that this fellow is pukka foolish. Medina is foolish. Now Medina wanted to try him for libel, for publishing two articles of this nature against him. Now Cuttings was on a transient visit to Mexico on a Sunday. And when he entered the state of Mexico, he was arrested. And afterwards, remember, he had to be freed for the simple reason Cuttings was so influential that he put the pressure on his government, that is the government of United States, to intervene to protect him. And the government of United States intervened and they got him released. Now the question that is being put is, the newspaper was circulated in Mexico. It was registered in Mexico. Newspaper was circulated in Mexico, but was printed in Texas. It was printed in Texas. He is an American national. Cutting happened to be an American national, was running the paper from Texas. And naturally, the case should be tried in Texas. Now, these are the type of things which come in state responsibility. What should be done? Now, there are other instances as well, which will call for a discussion a little later on subject of this type. Now, what the other development happened to be, there is something known as fault theory. You may be interested to know what is fault theory. If a state responsible for another state, there should be some reason for it. And what exactly are the reasons? Under international law, a state is responsible for another state if the act is done willfully, maliciously, and with utter culpable care, carelessness. So willfully, maliciously, negligently, and culpable carelessness. And only these are the four things that is being spoken. So naturally, the state is responsible if the conduct of the concerned state satisfies these four elements, then the state is answerable in international law. Now, a case came up wherein there is no malicious act, there is no culpable carelessness, there is no negligent act. Whether the state in such situations is answerable in cases of this type is the question that was put. Now, suppose, for example, if there is an error in judgment, a beautiful case came up before the Mixed Claims Commission, wherein now the Mixed Claims Commission pointed out, if there is an error in judgment, suppose, for example, the forces that were sent by the United States of America and England were jointly operating certain things. And when they were jointly operating certain things, the state of United States was answerable for errors in judgment. And they made certain mistake for which they were made to pay a compensation to the other state. Now, the most important thing is, the other important aspect that come in here is maliciously, negligently, and culpable carelessness naturally come in, especially in nuclear tragedies. You might be knowing the Treaty on Nuclear Non-Proliferation of 1968, signed in the year 1968, July 1st. The Treaty of Non-Nuclear Proliferation Treaty has too many articles. We just discuss only one or two. Article 1 of the Treaty on Non-Nuclear Proliferation points out, the states which have the nuclear power, are not supposed to give the nuclear know-how to the non-nuclear states. For example, there are several states which have the nuclear know-how today. United States, China, France, United Kingdom, even India, Pakistan, all of them have nuclear know-how. So a nuclear know-how state is not supposed to give the nuclear know-how technology to the non-nuclear states. This is Article 1. Article 2 of the Treaty of 1968 on nuclear non-proliferation points out, a state which is not having the nuclear technical know-how is not supposed to receive the knowledge. And under no circumstances, it is allowed to receive it. Now then, you may put a question and ask me, what about nuclear energy for peaceful purposes? Now, nuclear energy for peaceful purposes can be received by a state. Now, when it is received, by a particular state, the arrangement and modalities are actually answered by what we call as the an organization. And this organization is at the international level situated in Austria, and that organ naturally look into the matter. International Atomic Energy Agency is the organ that naturally looks into the organ. Through that organ, all the states are entitled to receive nuclear energy for peaceful purposes, with the result there will not be any problem. The next thing that is being spoken under the topic of state responsibility is relating to claims. Now, when I speak about claims, always remember, claim is made by the nationals who have suffered, who have become victims in another country. Now, it may be a corporation as well. It may be a state-run corporation, or it may be a private company as well. Lots of private companies run by the Tatas, the Rosis, the Modis, Mafatlals, they function abroad. Now, during the course of their functioning, if they suffer some problem, or if some injury or insult is being made to them and loss is being caused, and they claim compensation. Now, what is required at that time? First and foremost, the concerned company should have the nationality of that state. And if it doesn't have the nationality of that state, it cannot represent its matter before that court. Now, without nationality, they will not be allowed to go there and make an investment. But then it is one of the criteria that is being spoken. Now, when we speak of this aspect, first part, nationals, when they try to claim compensation in a foreign state for the loss of property, for injuries during the course of riot, for the destruction of their property, or something that has taken place during calamities of flood, famine, pestilence, and tsunami, are entitled, provided they have the documents to prove that they are the nationals of a particular state. This is the fundamental thing. Then, the Mixed Claims Commission, or the commission that is being appointed, examines the matter. When it examines the matter, having examined the matter, it awards compensation. Now, when it awards compensation, remember, they will get the compensation then and there itself. This is, for all purposes, we say, local remedy rule, which is very much essential, which is being part of the rule. Now, when the state takes up their claim to fight their case, suppose, for example, they have gone to the local court. When they have gone to the local court, there is denial of justice to them. Now, when I speak about denial of justice, what kind of denial of justice? Now, first one is, they go to the court and they sincerely, faithfully, innocently appoint lawyers. But then the court is one-sided. They are not prepared to hear their argument at all. This is one. The second one is, they hear the argument but then simply keep adjourning the case. There was a case which came up before the court of law, D. Elro mining case, wherein case was filed 9 years ago, 9 years have lapsed, but then for 9 years the case did not come up for a proper hearing at all. Or a hearing takes place but simply adjourning without giving anything. Now the third one is, they hear, but then the compensation which is awarded is just very little. Now, these are all, remember, denial of justice to the concerned party. Now, at that time, it will naturally invoke the protection of the home state. Suppose, for example, when it invokes the protection of the home state takes up the claim. When the home state takes up the claim, and through the diplomatic channel, it pursues the matter. And when it pursues the matter, and when it gets compensation, the basic question is, should the entire compensation be paid to the victim? Now, if it pays, nobody is going to stop. The state is empowered to pay, or it can pay the entire compensation. But there is no hard and fast rule to pay the entire compensation to the victim. Now, for example, the state may keep in itself a certain portion for the expenses that is incurred by it, one. the money that is being paid by way of service to the lawyers appointed by the state. Then the second one that is being spoken is for the loss of its reputation. We have lost our reputation because of this deed, and entire money cannot be given. And if that is being done, it is, remember, how much it pays is left to the state itself. Now suppose, for example, in a particular claim before the court of law, the concerned state, which is supposed to give the compensation, points out the victim has said he doesn't need any compensation. The victim speaks, no, I don't deserve, nor you have to give compensation to me. But in spite of this, remember, the state is empowered to take up their claim. Whether the concerned victim says that I don't wish to remember further the case before the courts of law, or nor my state intends to take up, still the state can take up the case and award compensation in cases of this type. Now there are other important issues that being spoken. When the compensation is given, to whom it should be paid? It should be paid to the natural victim. Now there was a case which came up before the court of law, and it is, the name of the case is I Am Alone case. Now in the I Am Alone case for 1929, the issue was the concerned party, during the course of the argument, pointed out, if you award the money to the de jure owner, naturally the money will not go to the de jure owner, it will go to the de facto owner. In the concerned case, naturally the de jure owner happened to be the state of Canada, and the de facto owner happened to be the state of United States. And in spite of this, the courts refused to do. Under the law, we have to act according to the prevailing rules and practices established by international law, and awarded the compensation to what we call as the de jure owner, that is the state of Canada in this case. Now how you distribute the compensation at a later stage, that is concerned to you, we are not involved. But then when we award the compensation, naturally it should go to the state of Canada. Now there was another issue that came up in the famous Barcelona traction case. Barcelona Light Hill Company, 1970, decided by the International Court of Justice. Now in the Barcelona traction case, the company was originally registered or incorporated in the state of Canada. The shareholders of the company belonged to the state of Belgium. But then the company was actually functioning in the state of Spain. Now the issue was a small issue, whether the shareholders are empowered to expose a claim against the state of Spain, wherein the company was functioning. The matter went to the International Court of Justice, and the International Court of Justice, having heard the case, pointed out, see, ultimately what we say is the place of incorporation, that is the state of Canada, always the Canadian law, that is the proper law in circumstances such as this. Now still the place of incorporation, that is the state of Canada, is functional. It is not non-functional, it is still functioning. In circumstances such as this, it is not the, what we call as the jurisdiction or the nationality of the shareholder, that is Belgium, that is relevant to this case, but it is the nationality or the incorporation, the place where the company is incorporated, to be relevant. Then again, a question was put, suppose for example, if the state of Spain were to take an action directly against the shareholders, if the state of Spain, wherein the company, Barcelona Traction Company, was functioning, were to take an action or initiate an action directly against the shareholders of the company, then remember, the Belgian law would prevail, because most of the shareholders happen to be the Belgians. This is how the nationality of claims have been pointed out before the court of law. Now there is the other important thing that is being spoken under the Investment Dispute Convention of 1965. Now for settling of investment disputes, a convention was entered, And this convention is popularly called as 1965 convention. The Convention on Investment Settlement of Disputes, remember, has certain flexible rules. Now, flexible rules simply meant the concerned person who intends to seek a claim or claim money through the damage that is being caused to him by a foreign state is empowered to espouse the claim directly, provided he has the nationality. Now, in the case of a company, all companies should have the nationality of the concerned state of which they are registered, and then their claim can be protected when the matter is taken before the court of law. This is the protection that is being given to them. Now, suppose, for example, in a particular case, the concerned victim goes to the court of law. When he goes to the court of law, the courts go to the extent of saying that we cannot entertain your case because we have no power to award compensation. So at that time, there is no remedy at all. So under the existing law, the concerned court has no power to award compensation of any type. This is one. Now at that time, naturally, their claim will be taken up by their home state, national state. The second instance happened to be a state wherein the executive of that state is in full control of what we call as the judiciary and the legislature. And the executive cannot be questioned before the court of law. A victim goes to the court of law. When he goes to the court of law, the court says, now the executive will be under full control and he is not subject to the jurisdiction of the court of law. Nothing can be done because it is provided in the constitution of that state itself, nothing but. Now the third instance happened to be an instance wherein no remedy to exhaust because the entire power is retained by a dictator and the courts are under the subordinate power of the dictator himself. He appoints, he dismisses, and it cannot be questioned. In situations of this life, there is no remedy to exhaust the local remedy because there is no justice to exhaust in situations of this type. In all these cases, naturally, they refer the matter to their home government, and the home government, through the proper diplomatic channel, takes up their claim to redress the damages suffered by the victims. Now, the last part which I just intend to speak to you on state responsibility happened to be damages. When I speak about the damages, always the state is answerable for the damages which are suffered by the nationals of a foreign state, or the damages which are suffered by the corporations of a foreign state when they are functioning in their territory. Now, the issue is, naturally, when I speak about damages, the actual damages which are suffered. An assessment of the damages that are suffered has to be made before compensation is paid. Now, a case came up before the Mixed Claims Commission, before the German and American Mixed Claims Commission. And the name of the case is Lusitania Death Claims. You may be interested to know what is this Lusitania Death Claims case. Now, Lusitania happened to be a British vessel. And a British vessel, when it was navigating, a German submarine was responsible in sinking the concerned vessel in 1915. And the German submarine, when it was responsible in sinking of the Lusitania, naturally, thereafterwards, it was referred to the American Mixed Claims Commission. It was referred to the American Mixed Claims Commission because inside the vessel, there were several American nationals who lost their lives when it was sunk. And American government wanted compensation from Germany. Now, the question came up during the course of the argument, whether vindictive and exemplary damages can be claimed in claims like that. Vindictive, because deliberately, intentionally, the German submarine was responsible in sinking of the British vessel. Could there be a count on this vindictive and exemplary damages? But the tribunal said there cannot be, and this count cannot be taken, and he refused to give any exemplary and vindictive damages. Thereafterwards, remember, another case came up in the year 1926. And the name of the case happened to be a Jane's case. In the Jane's case, for the first time, the Mixed Claims Commission pointed out there can be vindictive and exemplary damages. Now, in the instance case, this was a hero, an American woman, and the American woman was made to suffer so much. And suffer so much means, remember, she was insulted, humiliated, and she was not, the husband was killed. All these developments have taken place. And the very act which was done by the state of Mexico was, remember, reprehensible, and it was vindictive. Now, in addition to the compensation that she has suffered of losing her property, they gave compensation even for vindictive and exemplary damages. This was pointed out. Now, the other important development that I wanted to speak to you here happened to be a case that came up before the International Court of Justice, of which we have discussed earlier, but I shall speak the issues relating to state's responsibility in Nicaragua versus United States of America. Now, in this case, 1986, what has happened was the state of Nicaragua complained before the International Court of Justice that the state of United States has violated a treaty of friendship, treaty of friendship, cooperation and navigation entered between them in the year 1956. And this treaty was violated by the state of United States. Now, the state of United States did not appear before the International Court of Justice. Now, thereafterwards, during the course of the argument, the state of Nicaragua pointed out the loss which was caused by violating the treaty of friendship, cooperation and navigation was huge. And the International Court of Justice has to award interim compensation. And interim compensation has to be paid by the awarded by the International Court of Justice. And the assessment of compensation, how much it should pay, can be done at a later stage when once interim compensation is paid. Now, the International Court of Justice went to the extent of pointing out that the International Court of Justice has the power to decide the case. It has jurisdiction, fundamental. The second thing is, although expressly it is not provided under the statute of the court, whether it has power or no power to award interim compensation, under the provisions somewhere, it has inherent power to award compensation of any type. Now, then they said, if you are to award interim compensation and do something, hasty measures, it will be preventing the coming to the parties, that is United States as well as the state of Nicaragua, for a peaceful settlement in between, before the decision. So what we want is the parties should come together and enter into a negotiated settlement in a particular place. And once that is done, the matter will be resolved. However, the International Court of Justice pointed out, we will establish a procedure and decide a particular case. See, these are the developments which have come up before the International Court of Justice, wherein it has shown how it is empowered to adjudicate, develop, promote, refine, and define international law. Thank you.